Actually, this paper presents the current state of research of my master's thesis entitled Immersion in Multichannel Audio, Technological and Aesthetic Considerations of Sounding Bodies and Spaces. And I'm going to try to summarize some of the major aspects within the short time of 20 minutes. In today's media culture, it seems well established that current virtual reality and multichannel audio technologies are immersive, whereas the concept has already been critically discussed during the past 20 years, one can now witness a reinforced use of the term in the context of advertisements, art installations, and academic discourses. In this regard, immersion not only has become a buzzword to promote the latest cinema sound system or head-mounted display, but it also is also used in academic descriptions of experienced sonic phenomena. It is though questionable how the concept could be concretely outlined and finally employed on the field of sound. This paper examines the notional link between immersion and multichannel audio, starting by retracing some comprehensions of the immersion concept. In the second step, a very brief view on some of the sound aesthetic statements by Didier Anciaux and Jean-Luc Nancy will raise the question if sound could be seen as immersive per se. As you can remark in the title of this paper, I use the term aesthetic in its former Greek-like spelling. This is to make clear that I will stress the meaning of aesthetic as something pertaining to sense perception. I do apply a decidedly perception-oriented discussion of sound phenomena. In the last part of the presentation, a short analysis of the immersive potentials of one multi-channel audio system will follow. So let's dive deeply into the topic, and I will start by retracing some immersion concepts. Janet Murray's thoughts on immersion from a literature studies point of view are mainly understood as one of the starting points of the media theoretic discussion of the term. In her book, Hamlet on the Holodeck, she notes, quote, "The experience of being transported to an elaborately simulated place is pleasurable in itself, regardless of the fantasy content. We refer to this experience as immersion. Immersion is a metaphorical term derived from the physical experience of being submerged in water. We seek the same feeling of a psychologically immersive experience that we do from a plunge in the ocean or swimming pool. The sensation of being surrounded by a completely other reality, as different as water is from air, that takes over all of our attention, our whole perceptual apparatus." In this quote, the two main definitional strands of the immersion concepts are already recognizable. On the one hand, and this seems to be the most common nowadays, there's the technology and effect-based assumption saying that as soon as a dispositive is able to stimulate as much aspects of the human sensory apparatus as possible, it is to be understood as immersive technology. On the other hand, there's the narrative and content-centered understanding that implies that the feeling of being immersed in a media setting only can be evoked through a certain amount of involvement of the user into a story plot or certain logical fiction that is mediated. Both of them, and maybe all approaches to the term, have in common that they are assuming that immersion is linked to a feeling of diving into, to be engulfed by, to indulge in, or to be encompassed by a certain media environment or surrounding. The first perspective noted before concentrates on the capabilities of so-called immersive technologies to utilize the specificities of the physiology of the human sensory apparatus. In this context, every dispositive that makes use of the psychophysiological effects, such as the stereoscopic effect or the binaurality, is to be seen as immersive. The more a technology is able to trick the senses to pretend that the perceived is real, the more it is immersive. It is true that media technology intends to create a seemingly surrogate of a real by directly addressing certain sensory organs, but this purely technologically and effect-based understanding of the immersion concept is too narrowly considered. In this regard, Jesko Jockenhövel, for instance, has shown that a highly involved reception of a medium should not automatically be ascribed to an effectful medium. It thus needs to be stated that the feeling of immersion always depends on the subjective relation between user and technology, or recipient and technology. One who is familiar with a certain effect, such as the stereoscopy in 3D cinema, may not be as astounded by what he or she perceives as someone who experiences a certain media effect for the first time. However, that doesn't imply that familiarity with a certain media dispositive excludes immersive perceptions. Oliver Grau notes that immersion is characterized by diminishing the critical distance of what is shown and increasing emotional involvement in what is happening. As he describes here, a feeling of immersion just can be established as soon as the recipients are already used to the technological effects without denying their possible psychic or somatic impacts, because only then the effects don't obturate the perception of the entire media content, which also comprises its narrative and dramaturgy. Being familiar with certain dispositives can even facilitate the subjective willingness to engage with the displayed content. Besides the impact of the physiological perceptual effects, literary theorists and game studies researchers often emphasize the impact of narratives and plots within a media content, or only if the user is somehow involved in and engaged with the narrative content of the medium, a feeling of immersion can occur. Even though this approach alone is also not sufficient to encompass the complexity of the immersion concept, it fills the gap of the technology and effect-based approach by adding the subjective and psychological layer of user engagement with the medium. This leads me to some summarizing words on the immersion concept. First, it definitely needs to be stated that a technology and the effects it produces alone cannot be described as immersive due to the fact that defining a technology as per se immersive neglects the individual perception of the recipients. It is therefore useful to speak of technologies that could provide immersive potentials and effects instead of characterizing certain technology as genuine immersive. These immersive potentials, though, need to be augmented by some sort of narrative and or physical and psychic involvement with the presented content to ensure a subjective and personal relation to what is shown and what is happening. This aspect points to the need of a certain willingness of the user to indulge in the presented and subjectively perceived media matters. One of the major issues is that immersion is a description of a perceptual status, and it only can be ascertained in the aftermath of a reception of a particular medium dispositive. As it could only be attested retrospectively, an attribution of a technology to be immersive could be misleading. The concept of immersion could therefore be seen as an interplay of technological effects and physiological effects through the purposeful stimulation of the human sensory apparatus in combination with some sort of involving or engaging narrative dimension or dramaturgy. All that can allow the user to feel him or herself engulfed, absorbed, and or transported into the medium or environment by temporarily abandoning the distance between the medium and the self, between the mediated contents or realms and the real body space. This is also this last part is also so abandoning the distance between listener or user and the medium and the source of sound is also very important in the context of sound aesthesis, because as we all know, sonic phenomena are omnipresent and continual, permeating with vibrations that force bodies and objects to resonate that are denying borders such as walls or of a building or the human skin. Sound surrounds, pervades, submerges, and infuses every being, which is why psychoanalysts like Didier Anstieux or phenomenologists such as Jean-Luc Nancy comprehend sonic occurrences as a main factor in the placing and the apprehension of the individual self within its surroundings. I will read it in French, and I put the English translation myself there. Le soi se constitue par introjection de l'univers sonore. As Ancieux stresses, sonic occurrences can be understood as the introjection of the outer world, of waves whose derivation lies outside of the human body, but that are continuously resonating inside the corpus, its cells, and its liquids. Or Nancy further notes, le son se propage dans l'espace où il retenit tout en retenissant en moi. Sonner, c'est vibrer en soi ou de soi. Ce n'est pas seulement pour le corps sonore mettre en son, mais c'est bel et bien s'étendre, se porter et se ressoudre en vibration qui tout à la fois le rapporte à soi et le met hors de soi. In this respect, bodies are constantly embedded and submerged in sonic environments. Being situated in these sounding spaces determines that the affected bodies resonate themselves through which a particular sense of the relation of body and space and a certain impression of being in the world is generated. If sounds infuse and affect bodies, though also always question a possible separation between listener and sound source, could it though be stated that sonic occurrences and sound as matter do always have immersive effects? Are sounds per se immersive phenomena? Being an invasive physical force doesn't necessarily imply that sound evokes immersive effects. Nevertheless, these considerations, those sound aesthetic considerations, hint at the act of listening as a holistic, corporeal, and self-orienting experience, and point out that sonic phenomena constantly provoke somatic impacts. Even though it's inevitable to sense sonic occurrences, Even though it's inevitable to sense sonic occurrences at any time, there's again the question of the individual relation to the particular sound environment, which is perceived, and subjective, and the subjective willingness to be immersively affected by it. Therefore, the understanding of sound as genuine immersive phenomenon would dilute the debate on the immersion concept and would be too imprecise. To specify this issue, I come to the conclusion that it is inevitable to comprehend immersion as a decidedly media and technology-based concept. In this sense, immersion requires the transmission of sensuously affecting content through a technical or technological intermediary, so for instance, multi-channel audio systems. The media, so let's go on to the immersive multi-channel audio system, or so-called immersive audio. It is intended to scope with all these specificities of immersive feeling and being spaced somewhere, since the immersive multi-channel audio systems use the psychoacoustics and the physics of sound emergences to stimulate the human senses apparatus. So since the advent of stereophony, it has tried to stimulate the omnidimensional spatial attributes of sonic phenomena by emitting acoustic information through loudspeakers into space with the aim to create a convincing or realistic spatial sound field image. In the following, I would like to outline the immersive potentials of the current technology of wave field synthesis. In wave field synthesis, wavefronts rather than isolated phantom sound sources are produced as opposed to the conventional stereo and surround sound standards. A wavefront consists of all points in space that are reached at the same instant by a wave propagating through a medium. By the superimposition of such waves, the wave field at any point can be calculated, which is the so-called Huygens principle, which you can see here. In wave field synthesis, this determined wave field is then propagated by a huge number of narrowly positioned speakers, normally hundreds. And these can be placed linearly or cyclically in a certain concert or installation space. The result of this approach is that there's no sweet spot, but rather an extended sweet area in which the spatial quality of the sounds are equal at every position. That means that wave field synthesis thus can comprise a whole body sonic experience. The listener is free to move around in the listening space, and his or her body is entirely affected by the propagated sound occurrences. If you will, this fosters the feeling of the introjection of the outer world. The involvement of the listener in the displayed content, though, could be enhanced through such sort of systems. This is important to acknowledge, as other so-called immersive sound technologies, such as the binaural headphone sound mainly used in VR technology, don't deliver a whole body experience, but rather a solely oral one. In addition to this, the WFS systems open up a diversity of sound specializations. For instance, the specialization can evoke the impression of point sources located outside of the loudspeakers or even between the listener and the speaker array, so depth and movements through the listening space can be defined accurately. Contrast between sound sources with fixed positions and sources that move along when the listener walks through the sound field can be created. It is possible to create virtual room reflections and room dimensions. That means one can create every type of sounding space within a WFS production. It is though possible to create diverse, highly illusionary sound environments. These specificities imply that the WFS systems are able to mimic physical characteristics of sound propagations in an advanced and consistent way. Unlike other multi-channel audio systems that are, for instance, dependent on the paradigm of the sweet spot, this aspect allows the creation of highly fictional or virtual sound environments that can be perceived as to be, to a certain extent, realistic. There are some disadvantages of the WFS systems. First, they are expansive and expensive, so they are huge and does take a lot of CPU power, which is not such a huge problem at the moment, but it leads to another point that until now there is no WFS system that integrates a vertical level. For now, sounds only originate from the horizontal plane, and it's therefore not to be seen as a three-dimensional sound processing, as for instance ambisonics could be, but a horizontal two-dimensional. So the final step to attain a holistic and realistic sound field is not given to this point. Some composers, and this is really interesting when I read this, I was surprised. Some composers, so in this case is Boutros Noé, they remarked that the systems are sometimes too accurate in placing the sounds. And for the listeners, it's the challenge for localize and seeking from where the sounds are coming is getting lost. In the end, the systems are always visible, so we are faced with a huge interface. And due to the novelty and complexity of the systems, compositional approaches still have to be detected and described. That leads me to my final thoughts. And it has been shown that the immersion concept in relation to sound and multi-channel audio is a complex field that could be discussed regarding diverse aspects such as sound phenomenology, psychoacoustic technological specificities, and the distinct discourses on the term immersion. Moreover, it could be said that it is very shorthanded to simply label multi-channel audio systems as immersive per se. As discussed before, immersion depends on more than technological facilities and effects. It is a rather subjective and personal experience caused by multiple factors already mentioned. It could thus finally be stated that complex multi-channel audio system and productions can have immersive potentials and can enhance immersive feelings through the application of psychoacoustics and other effects, but the experience of being submerged into a different reality requires way more than only technological conditions. One last remark may be permitted. The buzzword immersion hovers like a sort of Damocles over the development of the multi-channel audio technology and the productions and compositions for it. Maybe it is a fallacy to be forced to concentrate on the evocation of immersive effects with a certain dispositive. Must a contemporary medium be immersive or provide immersive effects by default? I'm eager to discuss this further with you now or later throughout the conference. Thank you.
You asked with Nancy if sound is itself anywhere immersive. Couldn't we describe music as itself trying to be not immersive? Like, this is the discursivity of music is so clear in some kind of music that it actually tries to get away from this this problem. When it is immersive, it is also not distinct. So in this sense, that music is actually a way to be not immersive. And then that this explains why it is difficult to develop musical strategies for immersive technologies.
That's an interesting point. Maybe it's not enough time to discuss this whole musical issue in there, but I will stress on the first question or first remark you had that I was going by the theories of Jean-Luc Nancy to detect if sounds are immersive per se. This was just a starting point for me when I was concentrating on this point of immersion and multi-channel audio systems, because, for instance, scholars such as Francis Dyson ascertained to multi-channel audio systems and sound that it is immersive per se. In her book Sounding New Media, you can read it in several pages, and I was wondering if this is true, because I don't know, you can it's a really subjective way of thinking immersion, and it's something you can perceive only on your own, and you can only tell afterwards, yes, I was immersed. You cannot say that some certain technology is per se able to provoke and transmit immersive feelings, or this was the main factor. And if I'm not sure if the music issue, I'm not sure with it, because when the stereophony was introduced, or mainly introduced in the market, they really were advertising it that it is the best thing to feel, to be in an audience in a concert hall, and you will be completely immersed in it, and you will feel the music and hear the music as you would in the concert hall. So it is not like detached from this issue. The whole history of multi-channel audio systems mimicking realistic sound fields as displayed in audiences or concert halls. But yeah, the compositional issue is something else, I guess. This is also mainly concentrated on the technological possibilities and how compositionally the systems can be explored. For instance, Curtis Rhodes is doing a lot of research in this, talking about spatial chords he is developing in multi-channel audio systems, 3D ambisonic systems. But if you can say that this is music, this is maybe a bit too far away.
Talking about how we can't say that a media system is a priori immersive, but then I think of something like virtual reality. You know, I wonder if you would also say that virtual reality can't be a priori immersive, because I mean it's probably the most, I mean, if anything is going to be immersive, you know, the these headgear that you put on, and you're supposed to feel like you're inside in a different world. I mean, wouldn't you have to concede that that is kind of the most immersive media that
that exists? Yeah, this was also a question I was asking myself, and I had several contacts with this head-mounted displays in different contexts. For instance, art installations or art pieces in galleries, or even films and games. But I have to say, also Oliver Grau is reflecting on this, that the use of medium and media is also changing in cultural usage. So that means like who is surprised by stereophony nowadays as people were surprised then. But that doesn't mean that you cannot be or feel immersive effects or feelings with stereophony. Maybe you don't need to have a head-mounted display and 3D images and binaural sound you cannot say that it is a immersive medium per se, because you don't know how the individual is reacting on it. And when I had like this fifth time this head-mounted display on my head, I wasn't astounded anymore, and I was just like reacting when I was playing first-person shooters when I was younger, you know. And there are several people also like Ralph Knorr stressing that it's only just another display, you know, and it's using effects. The stereoscopy effect that is like the same as the effect as the binaural tree.
I think it was you first.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I'm okay. This is something in your talk where you talk about that there is this content that there's, I think you said a narrative, or you said a. I mean, okay. When you say that immersion is an effect, I was just thinking, okay, if you throw someone in the water, then they will be immersed, mm-hmm. even if they feel it, sense it as an effect or not. And I was thinking perhaps there was something in your presentation where you're talking about something that has to do with representation. I mean, where we feel a space that's not this space, but another space, mm-hmm. being immersed is like a virtual effect.
Mm-hmm.
So I think perhaps you could say that sound, in a way, is, I mean, when I talk, it is in a way immersive because it's all over. But you're talking about another effect. You're talking about the effect that it creates the feeling of another place than
yeah.
this place. So there's something about representation effect.
Yeah, thank you for this.
You say that's different
yeah.
than just immersion.
Yeah.
I'm not, my question is probably not
No, it's really good, because it hints to the point that in the discourse on immersion they have been raising a lot of other words describing something similar or something slightly different. For instance, this feeling of being somewhere else is the discourse of presence. For instance, Lombard and Ditten have been written on it according to virtual reality, that you have the feeling to be in another reality. So this is also a task that I still have to face in writing my thesis. You said I'm talking and somehow the sound immerses the audience. Yeah, but for me it's not immersion, it's invading, because it's just like permeating somehow through my liquids in my body or my cells or my skin. But if I don't have any point of involvement in what you are saying, I could not be immersed in your talk or in the things you are presenting. And this is something Oliver Grau is stressing, because this is also a problem, I have to say, because immersion in the Anglophone language really has a lot of meaning since a lot of time. You have the christening by the Baptists that submerges the whole body in the water. This is immersion. I'm not from the Anglophone world, that means that I'm like concentrating on it from a media studies perspective, and then I found it really difficult that a lot of people are just using the term without reflecting what it means, and they say, I go in the cinema.
That's probably where my question comes from, and perhaps somehow, I mean, nurture that this content that we have concept a bit. I mean, immersion for someone like me, so you could really pinpoint, I mean, what do you mean? I mean, you already did in your presentation with references to Mancini, but to make it very clear how it's not just in my immediate understanding of the word.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's now past one, but it's a very fascinating discussion. I will suggest that we continue it during lunch.
Sure.
I'm sorry if I, but we have a lot to say to each other, which is great. So I just want to say thank you, and it's actually, as I also mentioned with one of the speakers, we are leading up to some of the discussions tomorrow as well, with the ontologies and deontologies, the ideas, where are technologies pushing this whole field, right? So I think we have had four great talks about this, those issues, those questions. here today. So thank you. And the audience.
Thank you.